Australian Ambassador Amanda Gawley. Thank you very much for coming, Ambassador, and for supporting the project. And special thanks to my good friend, Chairman Ali Saikan. I'm going to say a little bit more about him in just a minute, Asi, so don't go away. I want to also acknowledge President Gilbert Lanto from the Philippine Institute for Development Studies. I'm a member, a fully paid-up member of the PITS fan club. I think PITS is a wonderful organisation, and I think you're now 40 years old. I was reading the Jerry Seacutt monograph on the history of the founding of PITS. I think PITS is the best institute of its kind in Southeast Asia, so I'm very pleased that we're involved with PITS. From the ANU side, great to have a strong representation from the ANU. I want to especially mention Dr. Imelda Denler, who's a human dynamo, who's really got the Philippine project going so strong. So I want to just thank all those people in particular. Now back to my friend Asi. When Asi first visited the ANU in around the early mid-1990s, he said, ANU's a good place, but by the way, there is a country in Asia called the Philippines. There is a country in Asia called the Philippines, and of course it's important you work on, you know, Indonesia and China and Japan and all that, but don't forget the Philippines. And so in a way, that visit by Asi in the mid-90s to Canberra kind of laid the foundations for where we are today. And so we had a couple of books along the way, and then where this presentation comes from is a project which, again, Asi's hand was heavily involved, which was the Ambition 2040 of the outgoing Aquino administration, where we were tasked to be involved with the preparation of a set of papers, so looking back and looking forward on the Philippine experience. And so that's what I'm going to be talking about today. Since that project got going, thanks to again to Asi, we had a conference in Manila, I guess a couple of years ago, and out of that conference came the presentation which I'm going to summarise today. And I want to just mention, I'll talk about it in a bit more detail, but just to say that this has been a wonderful collaborative project involving Professor Clarete Monching and Professor Mani Esguerra, who was then in government as Asi's deputy and neighbour. And I'm very pleased to say that several of the contributors to the volume, which I'll mention in a moment, are also with us. Gilbert, in fact, was one of the paper writers. Somehow he found time, in addition to being president. Jim Romaset, who's a remarkable character in so many ways, was a contributor. And Maha, next door to Jim, was involved not just with one of the chapters, but two of the chapters. So wonderful to see you both. And also Ron Mendoza, who will be speaking, I think, in the next session on politics. Hi, Ron, and so thank you very much. So that was kind of the background to the presentation. So here's, as Bjorn mentioned, an update, but it's an update looking sort of longer term back and a bit forward, rather than often the conventional sort of 12-month update. So that's the story. Now, fortunately, the book, as we prepared the book with the wonderful team, and the book has now been accepted for publication. It'll be published by the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies, Singapore, early next year. So the timing for this event is really fortuitous. So let me introduce the subject. We've called the book, somewhat provocatively, The Philippine Economy No Longer the East Asian Exception? We hope we can, you'll bear with us as we try and explain the motivation for this title and the book. And in a sense, the origins really come from looking backwards and looking back long term over the last half century or more of East Asian economic development, where in a sense the Philippines has been the exception. This is just a summary picture of 50 years of long-term economic development in East Asia, and this is by how many multiples per capita income has risen over this period. And the general East Asian story is one of great success. The Philippines has grown, but the striking feature of that table is how the Philippines has grown over this earlier period a good deal more slowly than most of its neighbours. in a sense that therefore there is the Philippine puzzle, why it hasn't grown faster. And that summarises the sort of long-term dynamics of the Philippines in the 1960s and 1970s being ahead of quite a few of its neighbours and then gradually slipping behind, relatively rising in absolute terms for quite a bit of the period, but slipping behind relatively. But there's another sense in which the Philippines is also an exception, and that came up in the presentation today by Chairman Balisakan, and also Ambassador Gulli, which is, in recent years, the Philippines has been an exception in a good sense. That is, it's been one of the fastest growing economies in East Asia. It's not far short of the growth of the Asian giants, China and India, since 2010. And as Ambassador Gulli mentioned, it's now the fastest growing country in ASEAN. So, in a way, it's a very interesting question to look at to understand the puzzle of this economic behaviour. So the background story is, I think, well known to all of you, so I won't spend much time on it. Essentially, it's one of arguably favourable initial conditions compared to most of its neighbours, therefore was ahead of most of its neighbours. But the record, the country began to falter in the 1970s, and then there was a very deep economic and political crisis in the mid-1980s, which meant that the country had 2 decades of essentially no growth. That is, per capita income around 2000 was about the same as it was in 1980. And the particular country comparison which was used at the time was Thailand. I mean, Thailand and the Philippines in some ways so similar historically. In around 1960, Philippine per capita income was double Thailand's. By 1990, it was the reverse. Thailand was double the Philippines. So in a sense, that's the backward-looking, rather gloomy story. And as you move forward from the 1990s onwards, the story becomes a good deal more optimistic. For a start, the Philippines avoided the Asian financial crisis, or at least it was much less adversely affected than, for example, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Thailand in 1997-98. And it was also only very mildly affected by the global financial crisis, in contrast to, for example, Singapore, Malaysia, and Taiwan. So thinking about this historical perspective, both the kind of the worrying but also the positive, the central question we posed for ourselves, which flowed from the task which was given to us by Chairman Balisakan and the ambition 2040, was to say, can the current momentum, the strong momentum, can it be sustained? And what we argue is that the issues which are, the way the issues which are addressed in this volume are addressed and handled will actually determine whether this momentum is going to be sustained. The way I approach this particular presentation is to develop what I call 10 stylized facts. 10 stylized facts of the country, and that's, as I see, that's a useful analytical prism for thinking about a country, in this case the Philippines, and for thinking about the issues which are addressed in this volume. Just by way of background, again, looking back historically briefly, sort of starting with what did the world look like in 1960, that is before the beginnings of the onset of rapid East Asian growth, except for Japan, which was already growing. You see very clearly from this table, the Philippines looked very, very promising. That is, its education indicators in particular were a long way ahead of most of its neighbours. It's striking, for example, that just on years of schooling, the Philippines was well ahead of Indonesia, for example. I mean, a very clear contrast. And the per capita income's a similar kind of story. Now, when you move forward over 50 years later, that's where the relative rankings have changed. That is, the other countries in the region have caught up and overtook the Philippines. And in particular, also, the earlier educational advantage the Philippines had was beginning to erode. So that, in a sense, is sort of a snapshot picture over this long-term period. Okay, on the book, this is how the book has been structured. In fact, Professor Clarete will present chapter 2 of the book on growth and poverty, and the overview, as I mentioned, written by Professor Esquerra myself. And then the following chapters look at more detailed issues. So Professor Corples on infrastructure urbanisation, Professor Villamil on education, Professor Banzon, Professor Ho on health, Professors Bromstedt and Rabago and others on environmental resources, Professor Rabago again and colleagues from UP on energy, Professor Lanto on development finance, and then Professor Mendoza on government institutions. So that's the kind of summary of the book. Obviously, I can't pull it all together in this brief presentation. The time's fairly rapidly going by. So let me just try and introduce the general subject by what I see as 10 stylized facts, analytical ways of thinking about the book. I'll go through some of these. I won't go through all of them because we haven't got time, but just to highlight, when you think about the Philippines, these are the kinds of the highlight sort of framework questions I think of. And so I'll just go through them very briefly in the presentation, just in case I don't finish, which is very likely. The key points to emphasize are the episodic development outcomes, very uneven growth rates, as I mentioned, over the period. Rather unusual sectorial growth story as well, conventional but also unusual. Major macroeconomic reforms. I think that the macro story is often under-recognised for the Philippines in understanding its success since the 1990s. Openness, gradual but partial liberalisation, infrastructure, the continuing challenge of infrastructure, the education advantage, but over time it's gradually shrinking relative to neighbours. Question of narrow growth and who gets the benefits of the growth is the central story. For institutions, a way of thinking about it is progress, but also a lot of complexity. It came out again in Professor Balisakan's presentation. Conflict and environmental fragility. So that's the kind of broad framework in which we're working. And let me just take you through some of the key points, again, just very briefly. The obvious first point is Philippine economic development has been highly episodic. That is, through until the late 1970s, moderate growth, similar to its neighbours, not quite as fast as its neighbours, but as we now know, that laid the basis for the deep economic and political crisis that occurred during the 1980s. The 1980s, in a sense, was a lost decade, deep economic and political crisis in the middle of the decade. Incidentally, very similar to what Indonesia experienced 12 years later, in 1997-98, then the restoration of democracy and a hesitant economic recovery. But it took till about the year 2000 to get back to where the country was in 1980. And then from the 1990s onwards, the beginnings of the return to economic growth, and over time, especially when the political impasses became less serious, the momentum has been strongly upward. This is another way of looking at the Philippine record comparatively, and this is comparing, again, multiples of current per capita income relative to a base year. And so the key point, if you look at the last column, is that the gap is really quite striking between the Philippines and neighbours from 1960 onwards. But if you look just at this century, from 2000 onwards, Philippines is basically in the pack. That is, it's very similar to its Southeast Asian neighbours in terms of the increase in per capita income. And in fact, if you were to do that story just from around 2010, it would be ahead of its neighbours. So that's the episodic nature of development. And again, the key question is, can this current momentum be maintained? The second part of the story is these unusual sectoral growth patterns. So there's a conventional story, which economists know well, which is that over the course of economic development, agriculture declines. And so you see that story. What the puzzling feature of the Philippines, again, is the way the manufacturing sector has not grown as fast as you might have expected. And again, there's a huge literature on this. In fact, the major intellectual contributions to understanding trade and industrialization in Southeast Asia came from this country. It came first with the seminal volume by Professor John Power, sadly just passed away recently, and Professor Jerry Seacat, who fortunately is well and truly alive and with us. I had lunch with him on Monday. And the Power Seacoat volume, which is a seminal volume, made the point that the Philippines made early into import substituting industrialization. And then it got stuck. It got stuck and had trouble getting out of it until really the major reforms happened during the initially 1980s. Arcee mentioned the very important volume by Bautista Power and Associates, a wonderful kids contribution to understanding Philippine policy making. But even though the reforms had begun in the 1980s, the Philippines missed out on a lot of the relocation of Northeast Asian industry, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and so on, into Southeast Asia. Unfortunately, that relocation coincided with the Philippines, in a sense, reconstructing its economic and political institutions. So what's happened is the service sector has been the major driver of growth, even with relatively low per capita incomes. And as we know, the service sector is a rather difficult sector to unpack because it's so heterogeneous. Part of it is it's a sector of last resort employment and very low earnings and productivity. Part of it in the Philippines, of course, the exciting story is the rise of the BPOs, where the Philippines has become not only a regional but a global leader. And I think this is one of the most interesting features of the Philippine economy in the last decade. My sense is it's kind of almost an accidental case of industrial policy success. And I don't think it was really a planned measure. Partly there were policies supporting it, but it's grown so rapidly. I think it's now about 7% of GDP. So this is another part of this Philippine story, which is really interesting. We discuss it a little bit in our book, but we didn't have a separate chapter on it. So that's the structural change story. And you see, of course, in the case of the labour market, a lot of labour still in agriculture, in very low agricultural productivity. And that links in a way to the poverty story, that when you've got these very large differences in intersectoral labour productivities with a large proportion of the workforce still in agriculture, that in a sense links to the poverty alleviation challenge, which Professor Clarida will talk about in more detail. The exports story is also interesting. One important part of the Philippine story is, especially in the 1990s, the country began to connect to global production networks. Remember, this is electronics-based primarily. Remember that more than half of intra-ASEAN trade is in global production networks, that is electronics, which are totally free trade because they have to be, because you've got global factories located in many countries, and you sign on to a thing called Information Technology Agreement, ITA. ITA 2 just signed last year with the WTO. And that has been driving quite a lot of the Philippine growth, especially during the reforms of the 1990s, when the Philippines became quite an important player. Okay, moving on. Yeah, okay, so one quarter of the way through and three quarters of the way through time. So the macro story, I think, is really important, the macroeconomic story. Remember, the Philippines had this really serious economic crisis in the mid-1980s. So countries learn from crises. It's a painful way to learn. But the Philippines learned, and it created, I think, what is now regarded as one of the very best central banks in the region, the BSP, which I think has been central to understanding Philippine development dynamics since the 1990s. Now, non-economists think macroeconomics is awfully boring, but believe me, it matters. It matters because if you don't get the macro right, you end up with these crises, which in turn mean slow growth and slow poverty alleviation. So I was due to give a talk at the BSP yesterday, and I was going to sing its praises. Unfortunately, I didn't quite make it to the BSP, but I think the BSP has been a very important part of the story. And I think it's replaced the earlier boom and bust episodic Philippine development story of quite rapid growth, running into a balance of payments crisis, slow growth crisis, and coming out of the crisis several years later. The Philippines really hasn't had an economic crisis since the BSP was established and became operational in 1992. And I think it's a key feature of the Philippine development story. Related to that, financial supervision has been improved a lot. And we know that most serious economic crises originate in the kind of the finance and macro sectors. So that's an important part of the Philippine story. Okay, so moving on to openness. I've discussed this already. partially the Philippines went down this import substitution route and had trouble coming out of it. It came out of it eventually through the reforms. Just in passing, PEITS played a key role in that, along with the UP School of Economics and the economic profession more generally. So the Philippines came out of that period of import substitution, but it had missed out on over a decade when a lot of the East Asian industrialisation had occurred. There's still some policy work, I think most people would say, in trade and investment policy reform. I'm an avid reader of Jerry Seacutt's Philippine Star Weekly column, and Jerry, who's, you know, in a sense the grand old man of the Philippine economics profession, does remind us that there's still a fair bit more work to go in openness. And you can see part of the indicators for that is looking at these comparative indicators of economic openness. Moving on, next is infrastructure, and since I've got President Marta sitting in the table in front of me, I wouldn't presume to talk about it, but it is just to note the point that the Philippines has been struggling with infrastructure management and spending. I think Arcee summed it up very nicely. Looking forward, this is a really exciting period for Philippine infrastructure development. In the slides based on Gilbert's chapter, we discuss in a fair bit of detail some of the infrastructure challenges. So running out of time. so just to highlight briefly some of the other issues. The education story is one of an advantage, and of course that's a key reason why the BPOs have been so successful, the education base plus of course language fluency. But the Philippines again has been, this advantage has been shrinking. It comes out very clearly in the education chapter, and of course it links very clearly to the poverty story, because we know that school dropouts are very closely associated, correlated with socioeconomic status of the household. One little footnote just on the education story. The Philippines, one would have expected earlier, the Philippines would become the regional hub for higher education. That is, the internationalisation of higher education has been a huge development in the last 20 years. And the Philippines has played a role in that, but it probably could have played a larger role if it had been more open. In a sense, ironically, Malaysia, which doesn't have such a strong education base as the Philippines, has become their hub, partly because it opened up more quickly. So that's another challenge. I think the Philippines will still be able to play that game importantly, but it perhaps could have played it even more if it had moved quicker. So narrow growth. I'll skip this section since it's a central part of Monchung's presentation, but again, it's a very well-known story. The key contributor on understanding Philippine inequality and poverty is of course asking themselves with a number of very important papers, and the poverty reduction of course is driven by the combination of slower growth and growth which is less poverty responsive. A very complicated story to do with public policy and redistributive policy. I think the labour market story is central to understanding the poverty outcomes as well. The positive one, of course, is the Philippines on gender equity looks much better than almost all of its neighbours. So it's again quite a complex story. And there's also a regional story to it, and the regional story is partly volume two of our joint work on Philippine subnational development, because the country is the second largest archipelagic state in the world, and so some of the bits of the country growing a good deal faster than others. So we're going to have a session, I guess, later on Mindanao. Maybe, Paul, your excellent book will come into that story as well, a very important book published earlier on this year. So next is institutions, progress and complexity. So we're going to hear all about it in the next session and beyond with Paul and Ron and others. Again, quite difficult to characterise the Philippines on institutions. Speaking as a simple economist, not as a sophisticated political scientist like these guys, clearly it's a great progress politically. The indicators show that. They show Philippines being, along with Indonesia now, the most sort of democratic, at least accountable society in Southeast Asia. But I think, as was highlighted again in Arcee's presentation, institutional reform more broadly has proceeded a good deal more slowly, especially the bureaucracy and perhaps also the legal system and the police system. So again, a very complex story with you know, some very positive stories alongside some challenges. That's just another way of looking at that story. Again, it comes out from the same sort of indicators that Asya presented. 1 minute to go. Okay, so with apologies to Jim and Maha, I'm going to skip the environment, but you'll hear about it, I'm sure, from their excellent chapter later on. So the sort of key message to get across, I think, is the Philippines is at the crossroads. That's a cliche, perhaps an overused cliche, but I think it's very relevant to thinking about the Philippines. It had a couple of pretty tough decades, and then it's had 15 pretty good years. And then since this, the question is, can this momentum be maintained? I think you have to feel optimistic. If all else fails, look at the lessons of history. I think the Philippines has absorbed those lessons of history very well. It's important also to just remind ourselves how quickly the development policy agenda has moved on and progressed. And I was thinking back, just summing up, when I first came to the Philippines to work in 1980, what were the key issues being talked about? It was how to reinvigorate the economy, which was then faltering. Well, the economy now is doing pretty well. It was how to improve macroeconomic management, which was suffering this boom and bust macro episodes. The macro story is now much better. It's how to achieve trade liberalisation. How was it then to achieve trade liberalisation? Well, a lot of that liberalisation has occurred, even though there's still quite a bit to be done. It was how to break out of the authoritarian politics. Well, that's been a very successful part of the Philippine story, by and large, as we'll hear later. And it was how to overcome entrenched inequality. And I think the striking feature is the progress which has been made on all of those variables, except arguably for the inequality story, which we're going to hear about. We're going to hear about next from Monjin. Looking forward, so we have a very nice part of the chapter, if I may say so. I can say it because I didn't write it. It was written by Professor Esguerra, trying to summarise where we're heading in the Duterte administration, at least the economics story. It's too early to say, of course, but the sort of the general story we try and present in the introductory volume of the book is to say that clearly the economic momentum has been maintained, that has been any real faltering of the economic momentum. The regime, in spite of very different political styles, the central policy settings of the administration, we'd argue, are fairly similar. Will the perhaps the more polarised politics affect the economy? Not clear. No evidence so far that it really has had much effect, but you never know. It could change quite quickly. Then we look at some of the markers. This is my last sentence. We look at some of the markers for how to think about evaluating the economic policies and outcomes of the Duterte administration. And here are some of them. We mentioned the presidential economics appointments, which have so far been pretty encouraging. Fiscal space obviously going to be quite a big challenge given the envisaged infrastructure spending rise, but so far so good. Federal system of governments, we're agnostic. We sort of need to see more to make an evaluation of it. Resolving the Mindanao conflict, clearly a really big development, so the developments in Marawi, very important. Reforming food policy, we think that's a big challenge. Not yet moved on a lot, but let's keep an eye on it. And how the country navigates its international relations with major partners. Thank you very much.